فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
As you are all aware of, we previously spoke about the difference between kufr, which is known as kufr al-mutlaq, and kufr al-mu'ayyan, the unrestricted kufr and the specified kufr. And we kept saying on many occasions that for us to place takfir on a particular individual and to say that this person is a kafir, there are conditions that have to be there, and there are also factors that have to be absent in order for that ruling to be correctly placed on the individual. And we brought evidence from the Quran and the Sunnah, and also some statements of the ulama. Okay, not only the ulama, but ulama al-muhaqqiqoon, scholars who have reached level of tahqiq. So now the question arises, what are those conditions that you're talking about, and what are those factors that could prevent a person labeling another person kafir? The conditions, inshaAllah ta'ala, are four. The first of them is أن يكون المعين بالغا عاقلا. The first condition is that the person has reached, they have reached puberty, and sanity is there as well. The reason why we say puberty and sanity together, because the child takes the ruling of an insane. Not that the child is insane, but the child doesn't know what he's doing, just like an insane person doesn't know what he's doing. So the first condition is that أن يكون المعين بالغا عاقلا. He has to be بالغ, he has to reach age of puberty, and he has to be عاقل, I mean, he has to be sane. Okay? The evidence for this condition, each condition we're going to mention, and we're going to mention the evidence for it. Evidences have shown that a child who's very young and a person who's lost his sanity, that they are both not going to be held account for what they say or do. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, رُفِعَ الْقَلَمُ عَنْ ثَلَاثَةٍ, the pen is lifted from three. عَنِ النَّائِمِ حَتَّى يَسْتَيْقِضَ, the one who is sleeping until he wakes up. وَعَنِ الصَّغِيرِ, and the young kid. حَتَّى يَكْبُرَ, until he reaches age of puberty. وَعَنِ الْمَجْنُونِ حَتَّى يَعْقِلَ, and until the insane one regains his sanity. Are you with me? Those are things that a person, if he's got, which is, for instance, the first one is sigar, his child, he's a baby, then in this regard, he is not going to be held account for what he does or says. And if the individual is crazy, they are also not held account for what they say or do. So this hadith shows what we would call سقوط التكليف عن هؤلاء المذكورين. They are not مكلفين. Because the قاعدة according to the علماء is البلوغ والعقل شروط التكليف. Are you with me? Puberty and sanity are conditions of takleef. Takleef means for you to be burdened and for the Sharia to demand something from you. So puberty is also sanity. Okay, if those two are not in place, the Sharia doesn't demand anything from you, nor does it prohibit anything from you. Are you with me, brothers? Al-Imam Ibn al-Mudhir rahimahullah, he says, أجمعوا على أن المجنون إذا ارتد في حال جنونه أنه مسلم على ما كان قبل ذلك. Ibn al-Mudhir rahimahullah, he brings in his kitab al-Ijma', page 122, that the scholars unanimously agree upon that the insane one, if he apostates, I mean, he says a statement of kufr, or he does kufr, إذا ارتد في حال جنونه, If he does it in his time of insanity, when he's insane, the Sharia, the Al-Mudhir says, أنه مسلم, he's a Muslim. If he says, he comes with apostasy, in a state of what? Junoon, whilst he's crazy, we consider him أنه مسلم على ما كان قبل ذلك. What he was before as a Muslim is what we consider him. We won't take him out of the fold of Al-Islam. Ibn Qudama, he says in his Kitab Al-Mughni, the 12th volume, page 266, he says, إِنَّ الرِّدَّةَ لَا تَصِحُ إِلَّا مِنْ عَاقِلٍ فَأَمَّا مَنْ لَا عَقْلَ لَهُ كَالطِّفْلِ الَّذِي لَا عَقْلَ لَهُ وَالْمَجْنُونَ وَمَنْ زَالَ عَقْلُهُ بِإِغْمَاءٍ أَوْ نَوْمٍ أَوْ مَرَضٍ أَوْ شُرْبِ دَوَاءٍ يُبَاحُ شُرْبُهُ فَلَا تَصِحُ رِدَّتُهُ وَلَا حُكْمَ بِكَلَامِهِ بِغَيْرِ خِلَافٍ. He says apostasy is not labeled, a person is not labeled to be an apostate unless he is sane. As for the one who has no aql, he has no aql, such as the child, such as the crazy one, or the one whose aql partially goes, such as the one who's sleeping, the one who faints, or the one who's sick, they are not fully lost their aql, but they partially lost it. So if a person, whilst he's sleeping, he goes, I am ilah, for instance. You see, he says that while he's sleeping. Or he says crazy stuff whilst he's fainted. Or whatever. All of this time he lost his aql, so he's not going to be held account for it. Or he takes in a medication which is permissible for him. Or shurbi dawa'in. Or he takes a medication, yubahu shurbuhu, it is permissible for him to drink. فَلَا تَصِحُ رِدَّتُهُ, his apostasy will not be taken him on board. وَلَا حُكْمَ بِكَلَامِهِ بِغَيْرِ خِلَافٍ, and there's no ruling on his wordings. His kalam is null and void. Null and void. Al-Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah, he says, فَلَا تَصِحُ رِدَّةُ صَبِيٍّ وَلَا مَجْنُونٍ وَمَنْ ارْتَدَّ ثُمَّ جُنَّ فَلَا يُقْتَلُ فِي جُنُونِهِ. Pay attention. If a person, فَلَا تَصِحُ رِدَّةَ صَبِيٍّ, a child's apostasy is not taken. When he does something kufr, is not taken. وَلَا مَجْنُونٍ, and one who is crazy, his statement of kufr is not taken. Are you there? وَمَنِ ارْتَدَّ, anyone who apostates, ثُمَّ جُنَّ, and then after becomes crazy. Are we all together? So a person that comes with apostasy, and then once he comes with apostasy, he becomes crazy after that. فَلَا يُقْتَلُ فِي جُنُونِهِ, no one can kill him while he's crazy. His apostasy was before he became crazy, but even then he's not killed. الشَّرْطُ الثَّانِي, the second condition, the second thing that makes a person, the second condition that is needed if you want to place kufr on a particular individual. وهو أن يقع القول أو الفعل أو المكفر من المعين على وجه القصد والاختيار. It is this speech and this action, which is kufr akbar, it occurs from this particular individual out of his choice. He intended to say it or he intended to do it. So this person intended to say this speech. He intended the speech. He also intended the action. So it's not that anybody put him under any duress. He is not under any subjugation. No one is forcing him into doing it. He's doing it with his own free will. Okay? This is a condition. If that's intact, then okay, he'll be labeled as a kafir. Based on the ayah, Allah says in the Quran, مَنْ كَفَرَ بِاللَّهِ, anyone who disbelieves in Allah, بَعْدَ إِيمَانِهِ, after his faith, after his iman, إِلَّا, exception here, إِلَّا مَنْ أُكْرِهَ وَقَلْبُهُ مُطْمَئِنٌ بِالْإِيمَانِ, exception is the person who is being forced, and his heart is in a state of belief, His heart is in a state of tranquility, meaning it is an affirmation towards Iman. ولكن but من شرح بالكفر صدرا فعليهم غضب من الله ولهم عذاب عظيم. As for the one who opens his chest towards this particular thing, فعليهم غضب من الله, this person has an anger from Allah تبارك وتعالى, ولهم, and it is for that person عذاب, a punishment which is عظيم, which is severe. So this ayah, what does it show us? That if a person disbelieves in Allah after they have gained Iman, but who's an exception? The exception here is إِلَّا مَنْ أُكْرِهَ وَقَلْبُهُ مُطْمَئِنُّ بِالْإِيمَانِ. This ayah came down on Ammar ibn Yasir, the companion. Ammar ibn Yasir, as you know, his mother and his father were killed in front of him. And he was also present when they were getting killed. So when he saw Abu Jahl, the way he dealt with his mother and his father, yeah, it was said Abu Jahl, he took the spear and he placed it in the private part of his mother. And she was the first woman who was ever killed for what? For the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he saw all of that and his father got killed in front of him, Abu Jahl gave him an option. He said to him, listen, if you insult Muhammad, I will let you go. And you have to remember, the kuffar reached a point where they knew that the Muslims would not leave Islam. They punished them so much, they were strong, they weren't leaving Islam. So it looked bad on them, the disbelievers. So they had to somehow find remorse in something. So what they would do is that the Sahabas were very strong. They wouldn't even give any disrespect towards the Prophet. Are you with me, brothers? So they forced Ammar, they said, look, we're going to deal with you like your mom and your dad. The only option that you have in front of you is what? To insult the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This him, this Islam and the religion, everything. So Ammar did that. When he did that, he came home to the city of Medina and he cried to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He said, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Messenger of Allah, I did this. I insulted you, I insulted the religion, he cried. The Prophet ﷺ said to him, how was your heart when you said that? He said, Wallahi ya Rasulullah, I was in belief of you. Wallahi, I believed in your message. Then the Prophet ﷺ said, فَإِنْ عَادُوا فَعُدْ. If they do that to you again, then do what you just did. So this ayah came in support of who? Ammar ibn Yasir. That Ammar's statement of disbelief, the statement, is not something he can be labeled with. Because he was put under what? He was under ikrah. إِلَّا مَنْ أُكْرِهَا وَقَلْبُهُ مُطْمَئِنُ بِالْإِيمَانِ. Lena Ammar is the one who used the word مُطْمَئِنُ بِالْإِيمَانِ. He actually said that. He said, how was your heart? He said, مُطْمَئِنُ بِالْإِيمَانِ. My heart was in a state of tranquility when it came to Iman. I had 100% conviction that this is the religion of Allah. Are you with me, brothers? Ibn Kathir said on the tafsir of this ayah, he says, اتفق العلماء, the scholars are unanimously in agreement, على أنه يجوز أن يوالي المكره على الكفر إبقاء لمهجته ويجوز أن يستقل كما كان بلال رضي الله تعالى يأبى عليهم وهم يفعلون به الأفاعيل. Are you with me, brothers? The person, he said, the ulama are unanimously in agreement. Ibn Kathir is saying this, that it is permissible that a person, he comes and he does things that are kufr under duress, under pressure. إِبْقَاءً لِمُهْجَتِهِ. So he can remain. Also, what falls under here is the person who's excessively happy, or a person gets excessively angry, where they what? They don't intend this statement. Okay? Like the person who's excessively happy, he didn't intend to say this. Like the man who, the famous hadith in Sahih Muslim, in Hadith Anas, the man whose riding beast left him in a land, open land, and all of his belongings were on the riding beast. All his belongings were on the riding beast. And then what happened was he finally received his belongings, and the riding beast came back. So when he received his riding beast, he took his riding beast, and this individual prepared for death. He buried himself a grave. He was ready to die. Okay? As he was ready to die, his riding beast returns. He grabs his riding beast from the فَأَخَذَ بِخِطَامِهَا. He grabs it from the front. ثُمَّ قَالَ. He then says, مِن شِدَّةِ الْفَرَحِ. Out of excessive happiness. اللَّهُمَّ أَنْتَ عَبْدِي وَأَنَا رَبُّكَ. Oh Allah, you are my slave and I'm your Lord. The Prophet said, أَخْطَأَ مِن شِدَّةِ الْفَرَحِ. This man, he done a mistake due to his excessive happiness. This man, he's not a kafir for this statement. Are you with me, brothers? You won't say, oh, him and Fir'aun, the same statement. أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ. He's a kafir. Why? Because here we say the speech and the action of this particular individual came based on what? على غير وجه القصد والاختيار. It came from him not because he chose it or not because he intended it. This person didn't intend it. ولذلك القاضي عياض, he says in his kitab إكمال المعلم, he says فيه أن من قال الإنسان فيه أن ما قال الإنسان من مثل هذا من دهش وذهول غير مؤاخذ به إن شاء الله. He says in this hadith is that whatever a person says out of he says it out of dahsh, meaning he's absent-minded. غير مؤاخذ به إن شاء الله. He's not held account for it إن شاء الله. Sheikh ibn Uthaymeen, rahimahullah, al-allama Sheikh ibn Uthaymeen, he has a kitab called قواعد المثلى في أسماء الله الحسنى. Sheikh ibn Uthaymeen, in that book, he talks about some masail pertaining to takfir, by the way. Some powerful points regarding takfir and matters pertaining to it. It's beneficial kitab. Sheikh ibn Uthaymeen mentions, when he was talking about the conditions of takfir and the obstacles, he says, وَمِنَ الْمَوَانِعِ أَنْ يَقَعَ مَا يُجِبُ الكفر أو الفسق بغير إرادة منه ولذلك صور. Ibn Uthaymeen says from the obstacles أن يقع ما يوجب الكفر, the obstacles that stand before a person falling into kufr or falling into fisq is what? Is بغير إرادة, when the person doesn't intend something. ولذلك صور. Ibn Uthaymeen says it has forms in which it comes in. منها, from the forms that it comes in is أن يكره على ذلك, that the person is put under force in it. Are you there? And we spoke about that, right? إلا من أكره وقلبه مطمئن بالإيمان. We mentioned that. That the person, he speaks a statement of kufr because he's been put under the pressure. فَيَفْعَلُهُ لِدَاعِ الْإِكْرَاهِ لَطْمِئْنَانًا بِهِ فَلَا يَكْفُرُ. He does that because he's been forced, not because he feels comfortable, that he's in a state of tranquility towards this statement or this action. No. That's one. The other form, he goes, أَنْ يُغْلَقَ عَلَيْهِ فِكْرُهُ فَلَا يَدْرِ مَا يَقُولُ لِشِدَّةِ فَرَحٍ أَوْ حُزْنٍ أَوْ خَوْفٍ أَوْ نَحْوِ ذَلِكَ وَالدَّلِيلُ مَا ثَبَتَ فِي صَحِيحِ مُسْلِمٍ عَنْ أَنَسِ بْنِ مَالِكٍ. And the second one is the one I mentioned right now, which is a person who is absent-minded, he doesn't know what he's saying due to the excessive happiness or the excessive sorrow and sadness which he endures. And the evidence for that, he said, is in what's in Sahih Muslim, in Hadithi Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu. We're now going to move on to the third condition. The third condition is قيام الحجة على الشخص المعين قبل تكفيره, establishing the proof against the individual before you place a takfir on them. You place hujjah on them, proof. Are we all together? So you have to establish a proof against the person. You have to what? You have to establish the proof against the individual. We already previously mentioned evidences from the Kitab and the Sunnah. وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَذِّبِينَ حَتَّى نَبْعَثَ رَسُولًا رُسُلًا مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنذِرِينَ لِأَلَّا يَكُونَ لِلنَّاسِ عَلَى اللَّهِ حُجَّةٌ بَعْدَ الرُّسُلِ. Those two verses were our evidences, right? That Allah does not punish a group of people until He sends a messenger to them. We already brought the evidences for that. We brought it from the Kitab, we brought it from the Sunnah, and we also brought statements of the ulama regarding that particular issue. So before you say this person is a kafir, what do you need, brothers and sisters? You need to establish the proof on them. You need to establish evidences against them. Once you've established those proofs against that individual, then and only then can you place takfir on them. Are we all together on that? Are we all together on that? Is the same concept as tabdi'? When you want to say fulan is a mubtadi', do you also have to establish proof against them? Does tabdi', placing bid'ah on somebody, does it also take the same? Yes, it does. Yes, it does. To say that this person is an innovator, this person is not from Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah, you have to establish the proof against them. But it's only when do you have to establish the proof against them? You have to establish the proof against them when is it? When they come with إِذَا خَالَفَ أَصْلٌ مِنْ أُصُولِ أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ. If he opposes Ahl al-Sunnati wal Jama'ah in a fundamental issue. If he opposes Ahl al-Sunnati wal Jama'ah in a fundamental issue, a mas'ala Ahl al-Sunnati wal Jama'ah have unanimously agreed upon. Ahl al-Sunnah have agreed upon it. Such as what? Ahl al-Sunnati wal Jama'ah have agreed upon that if the Muslim leader is oppressive, that the people have to be patient upon him. Ahl al-Sunnah agreed upon that. They mentioned that in the books of Aqidah. Ahlul Sunnah believe that if a Muslim leader is a tyrant leader, he's a tyrant leader. What is he? He's a tyrant leader. He's an oppressive leader. He oppresses the people. He whips them, lashes them, takes their money. Huh? What is it that they should do? They should be patient and they listen to him and they still obey him. Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, that's what they believe. Based on the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, وَإِنْ ضَرَبَ ظَهْرَكَ وَأَخَذَ مَالَكَ. If he lashes your back, he takes your wealth, the Prophet said, فَاسْمَعْ وَأَطِعْ. Listen to him and obey that leader. The Prophet said that. Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, what do they say? We do that. Are you there? Is this an issue Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah have agreed upon? Na'am. Are we all together? Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah agree on this. Somebody comes and says, no, I'm not going to, if an imam is ja'ir, he's an oppressive leader, okay? An imam is oppressive, we should go against him. Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah believe, before you do tabdi' on him, you have to establish a proof against him. Are you with me, brothers? The hujjah and the proof has to be established against him. And it has to be brought to his attention. If he then carries on, he's labeled as a mubtadi'. After the proof has been established against him, he is then what? He's boycotted. If the maslaha brings the boycotting, and there's a benefit in it, okay? But he is what? He is labeled as an innovator. Are we all together, brothers? That's the issue of us min usul Ahl al-Sunnah, masail Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah agreed upon. But if the person goes against Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah in the masdar al-talaqi, he goes against Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah in the source in which Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah take the evidences from. Are we all together, brothers and sisters? He goes against Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah in where the Ahlul Sunnah take the evidences from. Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, where did they take the evidences from? Al-Kitabu, Wa-Sunnatu, Wa-Ijma'u, right? If he comes and he says, I take singular narration in fiqh, but I don't take it in aqidah. Are you with me, brothers? I don't take singular narrations in aqidah. This particular individual, no proof is established on him. Yubadda. He's a mubtadi'. Why is he a mubtadi'? لأنه خالف أهل السنة. He opposed أهل السنة in the مزدر التلاقي which they take the evidences from. Does that make sense? If the person, for instance, says that the Quran is distorted, are you there? Or if the person believes that ijma' is not from the religion, all of that is what? There's no such a thing as ijma'. It doesn't exist. Doesn't believe in ijma', which Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah take. Then Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah consider that person a mubtadi'. Are you with me together? Are we all together? Proof and evidences don't have to be established against him. Doesn't have to be. Are we all together? Lakin if he opposes Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah in matters of usul, which are ijma'at of Ahlus Sunnah, Masail Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah have agreed upon in their books of Aqeedah. If he goes against Ahlus Sunnah, Hujjah, Tuqamu Alayhi Hujjah, the proof are established on him. If he carries on, then he's boycotted, then he's considered as a mubtadi'. So if we're saying that a proof has to be established on him in matters which are usul, then what do you think of masail which are furu'? Of course. Masail of furu', the proofs are established against him, okay? And even if he carries on, فَلَا يُبَدَّعَ. You can't make him a mubtadi' based on it. Are you with me? If it's a sub-branch, the issue that he's falling short on, are you there? This individual is not considered a what? A mubtadi'. Are you there, brothers? It's not said Fulan is a mubtadi' based on the fact that he believes this particular fiqh issue. He believes it this way. Are you there, brothers? We'll say that you're wrong in this particular issue. If the furu' become too much, if the sub-branches become too much. So first of all, he said music is halal. We said, okay, you know what? This is a far'i issue. So he did this mistake. We won't do tabdi' on him based on the fact that he said it's music is permissible. I take the qawl of Ibn Hazm. Proofs, we refute his opinion and everything. Are you there? لَكِنَّهُ لَا يُبَدَّعْ. He's not a mubtadi' because of that. Are you there? Then he goes and he says, لا, it is permissible for the man to have anal sex with his wife, مثلا. And then he comes and he says, the man can shake the woman's hand, who is not his wife or his sister or... meaning any woman, he can shake her hand, any ajanib, any woman. He says that. Then he comes out and he says, the men can shave their beards. And then he comes and he says, niqab is not from the religion. These are furu'. All of these coming together, now we make him a mubtadi'. He's a mubtadi' for that. He no longer is from Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah. So this issue of Qiyam al-Hujjah, establishing a proof against a person, is not specific to takfir only. It's also to the issue of a tabdi'. So one has to realize that. I'm going to now bring some other statements that some of the ulama have mentioned when it came to the issue of qiyam al-hujjati ala shakhs al-mu'ayyani, establishing the proof against a particular individual before you make takfir on them. Ibn Hazm rahimahullah, he said, وَلَا خِلَافَ أَنَّ امْرَأً لَوْ أَسْلَمَ وَلَمْ يَعْلَمْ شَرَائِعَ الْإِسْلَامِ فَاعْتَقَدَ أَنَّ الْخَمْرَ حَلَالٌ وَأَنْ لَيْسَ عَلَى الْإِنسَانِ صَلَاةٌ وَهُوَ لَمْ يَبْلُوهُ حُكْمُ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى لم يكن كافرا بلا خلاف يعتد به حتى إذا قامت عليه الحجة فتمادى حينئذ بإجماع الأمة فهو كافر. He says, Ibn Hazm, there's no dispute that if a person comes into Islam and he does not know the legislations of Al-Islam, he doesn't. And so because of that, he starts to believe that khamr is halal. And he starts to believe that it's not upon a person to pray. You don't have to pray. And the ruling hasn't reached him in this particular issues. He is not a kafir bila khilaf yu'tadu bih. There's no dispute amongst Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah in this issue. Hatta idha qamat alayhi al-hujjah. Until the proof is established against him. فَتَمَادَى. If he then becomes stubborn and hard-headed, فَوَ كَافِرٌ حِينَئِذٍ بِإِجْمَعِ الْأُمَّةِ. He then becomes a kafir by consensus of the ummah. So what's this? The kalam of the ulama. Now I want to, brothers and sisters, what does it mean? This is a very powerful point. What does it mean that the proof has to be established against this person? What does it actually mean? Does it mean that the evidence needs to be reached, the evidence has to be brought to them, and that's it? Or does the evidence have to be brought to them, And on top of that, they have to understand the evidence. Are you with me? Is it sufficient that you say to them, قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى, Allah said, when you read the ayah in Arabic, and that's it? Or is it a condition that you explain and you go through and you detail and you explain it for him until he understands everything? Is that a condition? Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah differed amongst themselves two views. There are two views on this amongst Ahl al-Sunnah. One view is that the hujjah has to be established against the person and they have to be understanding the proof. They have to understand it. Are you there, brothers and sisters? So it has to be iqamatul hujjah. The proof needs to be established against the person. Wa fahmihi laha. And you have to explain the proof to them. You have to basically, they have to understand it. They have to understand the intent behind these textual evidences. Many of the ulama have said this. This is the view held by Ibn al-Arabi, rahimahullah, the great Maliki scholar. Ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi, rahimahullah. Shaykh al-Islam, Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah. Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah. And inshallah ta'ala, their statements will come soon. Very soon, inshallah ta'ala. I'm going to bring their statements, inshallah, at the end. Are you there, brothers and sisters? Are we all on the same page? Yeah. The second opinion is, أَنَّ الْحُجَّةَ تَقُومُ عَلَى الشَّخْصِ. The proof will be established against the person even if he hasn't understood it. Even if he hasn't understood it. Are we all together, brothers and sisters? This, the proof is in the fact that the adillah has been brought to you, even if you haven't understood it, is still a proof against you. And they say, these scholars, they say, فَلَيْسَ مِنْ شَرْطِ قِيَامِ الْحُجَّةِ فَهْمُهَا. From the condition of the proof being established against you doesn't mean that you understand it. And this view is pushed by al-Shaykh Ishaq ibn Abdul Rahman ibn Hassan ibn Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab. And he mentions that this is a view held by many of the A'immat al-Da'wah al-Najdiyah. The A'immat al-Da'wah al-Najdiyah. Are you there? And he actually wrote, Ishaq ibn Abd al-Rahman, Ishaq ibn Abd al-Rahman ibn Hassan, he wrote a risala. He called it risala to hukm al-takfir al-mu'ayyani wal-farq bayna qiyam al-hujjati wa fahm al-hujjah. Are you there, brothers? Page 90, he goes in more details, and I'm going to bring his statements as well, inshallah ta'ala, later. What's the evidence that the second party used? Okay, they used the kuffar of Quraysh, the kuffar in which the Prophet ﷺ was sent out to. Are you there? The kuffar in which the Prophet ﷺ was sent out to, the proof was established against them by them hearing the Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly tells us in the Quran that they were not actually understanding it. As Allah said in the ayah, أَمْ تَحْسَبُوا أَنَّ أَكْثَرَهُمْ, you think that the majority of them, يَسْمَعُونَ, that they hear, أَوْ يَعْقِلُونَ, or they understand. Allah says, إِنْهُمْ إِلَّا كَالْأَنْعَامِ بَلْهُمْ أَضَلُّ سَبِيلًا, meaning they don't hear, nor do they understand what's being said. إِنْهُمْ إِلَّا كَالْأَنْعَامِ بَلْهُمْ أَضَلُّ سَبِيلًا, they are like the cattle, the animals that don't understand what's being said to them, or rather they are worse than the animals. This is the verse that they used. They use verses and evidences like that. After observation and looking at both sides and what they pushed, for me personally, the first view seems right, which is the proof has to be established and the evidences have to also be mentioned and the person should understand it. So it's not just the evidence is reaching the person. Understanding the evidences is also what? It's also something a person, it has to be there. Because a person who didn't understand something and doesn't know what's being said to him, The proof hasn't been established against them. And the Qur'an, it consists of what? It consists of what? It consists of wordings, and it consists of meaning. The Qur'an is not just mere wordings, it's actually meanings. And the meaning is what hasn't reached this person, the wording has. And the Qiyam al-Hujjah, it encompasses both. And the one that it says that's only the wordings, he's narrowed down the Hujjah. He has narrowed down the what? The proof. He said it's one over the other. He needs to bring a solid evidences. And the evidences that they brought, we will respond to it, inshallah ta'ala. But what we want to bring, the evidences that show that the proof has to be understood. The evidences that we're going to bring, inshallah ta'ala, and we're going to expand on this issue, is we're going to be taking it from the kitab Tariqul Hijrataini. We're going to be taking it from the kitab written by who? Ibn al-Qayyim, Tariqul Hijrataini. We're taking it from that book, inshallah ta'ala. I'm going to conclude there, inshallah ta'ala. Anything which I've said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and Shaitan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.